sponsor the 88th Miss University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, and I am elated to serve as your mistress of ceremony this morning. Welcome to the Arkansas Legislative Black Caucus Black History Month kickoff. It is my honor and pleasure to serve as your mistress of ceremony. We have a great program which will proceed as printed. I will keep us flowing and on time. So sit back, relax, and help me give a warm welcome to my fellow HBCU student, William Boyd, as he comes to give our invocation.
As invocation, I would like to say a prayer. If every head be bowed and every eyes be closed. Yahweh, I thank you for this day you have made. You are glory and you are praised. You are the Alpha and Omega. You are the beginning and he who holds the end. All the earth is full of your glory. You form man from the dust, and the dust they shall return, O Father. You multiply your mercy, and even the countries of this world have hate to one another. Even when man denied you and your stature, when man said in their hearts there is no God, they are corrupt and have done abominable things. There is none who does good. They have turned freedom into bondage. They have turned justice to immorality. We have exercised lawlessness and placed idols in our hearts. We smell disgusting in your nostrils. Even the leaders of this earth have great fault because they do not regard your will. But they wake up every day in their hearts and they plan in their own hearts as if they were gods and not just men. But Lord, you will destroy the wicked. The portion of their cup shall be burning winds and darkness, gnashing of teeth because of unquenched fire. You laugh at them because you know their end. And look, there they are in great derision. Father, I give you thanks, for the earth is yours. All creation is yours. From the beginning, it was you who elected our leaders of the earth. It is you who hold the celebration today. It is you who ordains the hearts of men according to their ways. I will not beg for peace, nor will I beg for prosperity. But I beg not our will, but your will be done. That they may know you are Yahweh Yeshua, God who doesn't take pleasure in wickedness. That they may know you are Yahweh Gadol Machamah, Lord mighty in battle. That they shall know you as Yahweh Shammah, Lord who is there. For I loose the Holy Spirit, who is the spirit of understanding and wisdom, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of God, and the spirit of adoption upon myself, my family, my state, my country, and my leaders. I invite you, Holy Spirit, who is the spirit of power, of love, and of sound mind against the spirit of fear. Father, pour out your Holy Spirit to convict the world of sin, to break their hearts to see truth. Above all, I pray your will, Father, be done on earth as it is done in heaven. For our Father who art in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is done in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead this country not into temptation, but deliver it from evil. For it is your will, it is your kingdom, it is your power, and it is your glory forever and always. In Yeshua's name, in Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen.
Amen to that one. So good morning to you all. So, you may wonder why I'm standing before you today. So I'm here before you today to give the purpose. My name is Russell Williams III, a junior political science major at Philander Smith College, a native of Opelousas, Louisiana, and I proudly serve as Student Government Association President in my illustrious institution. Today's program is important, not only for the caucus and the governor, and all of you seasoned adults with many years of work, life, and service experience. Today is important to me and to the students asked to attend and to take part in recognizing, celebrating, and kicking off Black History Month in this great state of Arkansas. So at this moment, I would like to ask all students and young adults to please stand. And here's a message. As I look into your faces,
I want you all to know that your presence is recognized and felt. Let us learn from the members of this caucus that whether we choose to accept the call to service now or further down the line, it is always ours to accept, and that there is never such thing as waiting your turn. For once and for all, Black history is for all of us and for all of us to share. Learning and knowing our history, learning from that history and living out the lessons and traditions of our parents, forefathers, and leaders is what truly makes us great. I want to thank the Black Caucus for including us and inviting us to take part in today in what will be surely tomorrow's history. I now ask you all to stand as we recite the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you all very much.
Good morning. I'm starting to think it was a mistake to put myself behind these talented young people. I'm just going to be brief and say that this is somewhat of a homecoming today, not only a celebration of this beautiful exhibit and a celebration of the legacy that so many before us have left for us, but also a celebration of Black history and Black History Month. I want to just say a couple of things. First, this is sort of surreal for me because I had the honor and the pleasure to work for the Legislative Black Caucus many years ago. I won't date myself and tell you when, but it was a long time ago. And at that time, I had an opportunity to read the University of Arkansas Historical Quarterly and learn about so many members of the legislature who were African American, who I'd never read about, I'd never seen their pictures, I never learned about their contributions to this state. And at that time, I made it my mission to make sure that everything we did, it would be something that was brought before people. And people always said, oh, I didn't realize that history was there. Well, here today, we have a great opportunity to see that history and build on it. There's another scholarly article which we'll share online, and I encourage the students to read it, that shares about the work of so many of the people. You see their faces here, and some of them are faceless, all the way back in 1868, having a role in the establishment of public education right here in this state. You didn't read about it, and sometimes you don't read about the contributions of members now because a lot of the work that we do, we work behind the scenes. But I just want to thank the Secretary of State's office and the wonderful work of Dr. Ware for working on this exhibit and updating it. I want to thank the Governor's office for partnering with us and bringing his proclamation in conjunction with our program. And there are several people to thank. Central High, Philander Smith College. This is an effort brought by many, and certainly my colleagues, who always, you know, we always work together for the things that we know are important and a part of our responsibility, our unique responsibility to the state to share Black history, which is Arkansas history and American history. So with that, I thank you very much, and I'm ready to see this program move forward.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jamie McAdoo. I'm a junior at the Little Rock Central High School, and we, as the Righteous Poetry Club at Central, have some poetry for you all. So, can everybody snap? Can everybody say, mmm? Can everybody say, ooh? Can everybody say, wow? That's called feedback. So if y'all hear something y'all like with my poem or the next poem, please give us some feedback so we can know, okay, I did good with that line, or okay, they weren't really feeling that line. But with any further ado, I will proceed. As being at Central, we were told to write a bunch of poems about the Little Rock Nine because we were highly involved in the 60th desegregation stuff that went on earlier this year. And so here's a poem about it. It's called Lessons Still Relevant. My parents were my first history teachers. At an early age, in my earliest days, I was taught the culture behind my race, the beauty beyond my face, the common inventions and ways of living that you can trace back to Africa. I knew about the brotherhood that was taken from the motherland. My mother's hands never tamed my natural roots. My mother's hands held me as we watched Roots. My father's glance compelled me to pay attention to Roots. My brother and I watched Eyes on the Prize. My brother and I watched documentaries that show Martin Luther King die, Emmett Till die, black people die. In America, black people die. My brother and I watched the news as Trayvon Martin's parents cried. My parents took us to museums and we observed the gyms. They took us to lectures and we listened back then. They taught us about Central High School too, way before we went to school. And in a way, I feel like the 10th Little Rock Nine from behind, the little sister of them all, the fly on the wall, the shadow on call. And I saw how they were treated. And I saw how they retreated and nonviolently fought the system that fought them back 10 times harder. I saw because I am the daughter of the movement. I knew this at an early age, so by ninth grade, I expected attending Central High to be iconic, to be as if I would be a part of history. I represent the third wave generation after the integration, desegregation. It's amazing that it wasn't that long ago. I know that we have come from a long ways, but we still have a ways to go. But at least in Arkansas, we can say it started at Central High. Where I am not greeted every day with 2, 4, 6, 8, we don't want to integrate shoutings. A school that has over 20 languages and counting. A place, again, that I am not greeted every day with 2, 4, 6, 8, we don't want to integrate shoutings. In 1957, Central High was the beginning of change. And I knew this at an early age, I mean in my earliest days, because my parents were my first history teachers. Thank you.
That's my little sister. I taught her everything she knows. But so for this next poem, I decided to get some of my classmates to help me. They're not on the program, but their name is Chauncey Williams Wesley and Traylon Cranford, and I am Nora McAdoo, and we're gonna do a group poem.
Can you all hear me? Can everyone hear me?
Yeah. Okay.
Pencils.
Check.
Paper.
Check.
Notebooks.
Check.
Courage.
Check.
Perseverance.
Check.
Nonviolent mindset.
Check.
1957 was nowhere to heaven. Black student education was a threat, so they made sure we felt threatened. Ignorance was the strongest weapon, so we were granted better school and credit. Nine adolescents came face to face with oppression. Set in, right here, in Little Rock, Arkansas. I feel
confused. I left on a horse, man, and I was heavy-hearted. Lasting friendships gone within an instant. I barely had enough time to say goodbye, but had just enough time to say hello as I picked up that phone.
I can kill you without even flinching.
Every night back at home.
Pick one. Hanging.
Or lynching. Stop calling me. How did I get here? Big man on campus 1 second.
Black bullseye the next.
Looking foolish. One heck of a fall from grace at the time I was clueless. Mama said, we still part of the human race and that's why I gotta do this. Even though at times I didn't think I'd get through this and the prayers might not have made the glass less sharp. But the blood that ran from my body was that of a tiger. I couldn't see past my nose, but see what they didn't know was that when I bled black and gold.
I feel pressure.
One, point of view.
Two,
things you thought you knew.
Three,
birds got shot but still flew. I'm a prisoner. A prisoner of the pressure that confined myself within, only to be held hostage not only to myself, but to the vicious anger portrayed in everyone else. Walking down the hall like a total of vicious cruelty, walking down the stairs as people continue to stare, and this is all just on a journey.
Headed home.
The oldest will still take care of true duties. Sometimes wish I could just click my heels 3 times and disappear. Maybe that's my excuse for leaving after my junior year. The pressure had me down, yet I had these guys to lift me up.
I feel
anxious. I was just beginning to feel the heat. As summer ended, the pressure was all on me, the whole family.
The whole race was dependent on me.
I'm anxious because at this point, this is more than just going to school. I wake up at night in cold sweats because of dreams of death threats and missiles constantly aimed at my neck. I hope this pays off.
How am I helping?
My pops got laid off.
This is too overwhelming.
My homie's calling me. Solving
am I ready for this blessing?
I gained strength from my older brother. The other day, he turns to me and tells me,
I look up to you.
And it meant so much because I'm the youngest. I'm just a baby.
Jeff, quit that talking crazy.
You continue to outdo me and amaze me.
It sounded great, but it didn't make anything easier. The tag still hurt.
Kicks to the head got worse, and glass cuts were nowhere near perks,
but it made my heart stronger. Made my will last longer. I got past all the tears. Kept my head through the lost year, and now I can say I'm a graduate. Mama.
Don't cry no more.
Daddy.
Don't cry no more. We were ready. Everything you could ever check for.
With three small victories in this war. Role models for future generations to push towards.
60 years and this is a war we still can't afford.
Blacks get set back every day.
It's unfair. But we can still celebrate the progress we all share. We're proud Tigers.
Can I get a roll call?
Ernest Green.
Terrence Rock. Jefferson Thomas.
Central Hoorah. Yeah.
My name is Reginald Murdoch, and I represent District 48, which is the Delta of Arkansas. I said the Delta of Arkansas.
Yes.
My task is to represent past members of the Arkansas Legislative Black Caucus. I don't know how many are here, but I passed some as I came in. So I want to take this time, unless we have a list or rostrum. Okay, so I get to represent the present members that are here. So that should be a little easier. So at this time, I'm gonna ask all of the current members, present members, to stand. Please stand. Let's give them a hand, please. These are the members that that serve so gallantly and tirelessly for you. In this General Assembly, and it's a pleasure to serve with them by name. Representative Vivian Flowers, Representative Charles Blake, Representative Fred Love, Representative Kenneth Ferguson, Representative Milton Nix, Senator Joyce Elliott, Senator Linda Chesterfield, Senator Stephanie Flowers, Representative John Walker, Representative David Fielding, Representative Eddie Armstrong, Representative George McGill, Representative Monty Hodges, and Representative Fred Allen. Representative Flowers will, and Senator Elliott, as she comes forward, will recognize past members of the Legislative Black Caucus. Let's give her a hand as she cameos in.
And we know Senator Elliott is always right on time. So, as I mentioned earlier, this is somewhat of a homecoming, and as you'll see when you get a chance to take a look at the exhibit, there are several members who we would love to highlight and say their names. You don't have to, though, because in your programs we have every member listed. But for now, if those of you who are here who are former members of the legislature and former members of the Legislative Black Caucus, please stand so that Senator Elliott can recognize you. Thank you.
I hope I remember them all. Am I supposed to?
So am I starting up here, Senator Chesterfield? Thank you. District what? District 30. And? Representative D. Bent. Okay. And at what district was that? 59. Boy, things have changed. Representative Charles Armstrong. Representative Joe Harris. I don't know everybody's numbers. Representative Nancy Blount. So we miss all of you. And Representative Judy Smith. And my classmate here. Representative Booker Clemens, I haven't seen you in a long time. And Representative Ernest, now Judge Brown, correct? Did we miss anybody? Okay. Representative Wilhelmina Llewellyn. And Representative John Llewellyn posthumously, thank you very much. Representative and Senator Tracy Steele, is there anybody else? I'm almost out of breath because I was running up here to try to be here to do my part. Representative Murdoch, thank you so much. We know that once you have served, you still have lots more to give. and I think it's really, really important to have your presence here today to remind people that once you have served up here, you're still serving in other ways, and also to encourage other people to understand what it means to please step up and serve, because we need everybody, you know, to help us float this boat. Thank you all very, very much.
And this is just a tad off program, but if all of you can take a look in the middle of your booklets, you will notice in memoriam, we wanted to recognize Senator Gene Edwards and Representative John Llewellyn, who we lost late last year, I think about 2 days apart. And I couldn't help but think about how James Baldwin said, history is not the past, it is the present. We carry our history with us, we are our history. And so in honor of Senator Edwards and Representative John Llewellyn, if we could take just a few seconds of a moment of silence.
It is my honor to introduce our next presenter. He travels all over the state of Arkansas, representing our state, and he travels all over the world doing the same. In that regard, he needs no introduction. I'm sure you all know that he is from Northwest Arkansas and know his extensive record of service in Washington. So I'll simply share that our next presenter understands that Black history is Arkansas and American history. He understands the values of HBCUs, and he also understands the impact that we have on the state's economy as well as Arkansas history. And he understands that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is an American hero and is an example for all of us Arkansans. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome the 46th governor of our state, Governor Asa Hutchinson.
I don't know about you, but I'm very proud of the students that have presented today. Salonika, thank you for the introduction. UAPB students, incredible poetry in action. Central High School, we've heard from UAPB though as well, and then Flanders Smith. Yes, it's even more impressive. Give them a round of applause. Great job. It's appropriate that during this Black History Month that we all celebrate together not only the history that has made a difference in our nation and in the state of Arkansas, but also to recognize the significant contributions of the Legislative Black Caucus. And now, I have not known them all through history, although I've known a few of them. But I do know the ones that are here today and those that serve in the legislature and work with us day in and day out. They represent a very important voice, not just an important voice, but a critical voice in the Arkansas General Assembly. There would be a tremendous vacuum. There'd be a tremendous void without the voice and perspective of the Legislative Black Caucus. I know that we share most values together. If you look at our values, we share most of them together because we're Arkansans, because we're Americans, because we have the same love and interest. But guess what? We don't all have the same experience and perspective. And so while we share values, it is that perspective, it is that experience that you bring that is irreplaceable in the Arkansas General Assembly. I'll also say that they are good partners. We don't always agree. That's what the legislative session is about. But we also are very good partners. And I want all of the students and everyone here today to know that this Legislative Black Caucus have advocated for some very good things. They have advocated for maintaining and making sure that we keep Black history as a prominent part of Arkansas history. And their commitment to the Mosaic Templars Cultural Center, that is one of the preservations of African American history in our state, is an important contribution that they make and they advocate for. They advocate for pre-K education regularly and consistently, and successfully, I might add. They're an advocate for historic Black colleges and universities. For funding, for recognition, for their students that have demonstrated such abilities. They are an advocate for the economic growth in the Delta of Arkansas. And so many other things that we share in common, but they are a strong advocate for everything that's important and for their perspective from their experience. Your representation and voice should increase in the Arkansas General Assembly and not decrease. And I say that because we have reapportionment coming up in a couple of years. And it is important that Arkansas in the General Assembly reflects the diversity of the state of Arkansas. So as we enter Black History Month, we can look back 150 years in Arkansas history to find that our state can boast of courageous Arkansans who helped to set the course for civil rights leaders of the future. One of those men is Anderson L. Rush, who in June of 1868, Mr. Rush introduced a bill in the Arkansas General Assembly that allowed Blacks the right to serve on juries. This law was passed. It was signed into law on July 13, 1866, and it distinguishes Mr. Rush as the first African American in state history to introduce a bill that became law. It was right, it was just, and important. 32 African Americans served in the legislature between the end of the Civil War and the turn of the century. William H. Gray, Richard A. Dawson, Ferdinand Havis, James T. White, and John Rollins were among them. For those who want to follow the history of Black Americans, I'm delighted to say the U.S. Civil Rights Trail has launched a website that reflects beautiful and historic photographs, interviews, and guess what? 10 of the sites on the trail are in Little Rock. And that simply reflects the fact that our African American leaders here in Arkansas were a part of the struggle. They were a part of what was important in American history, and that changed the tide from something that was dark and wrong to a better life for the next generation. And it's my privilege today to present to the Legislative Black Caucus, represented by Representative Vivian Flowers, a proclamation, and I'll read a portion of it. Whereas February is designated by the President as National African American History Month, a time for honoring and exploring the culture and history of Black Americans, and recognizing that our society's rich diversity is one of our greatest strengths. And whereas countless courageous African Americans fought extraordinary battles through this country's history to achieve social, economic, and political equality and justice. And whereas looking past the painful history of inequality, there are those Arkansans, brilliant African American artists, talented musicians, successful professional business and industry leaders who have overcome. And whereas today, outstanding African American jurists and Black members are on the bench, overseeing the same courtrooms where their God-given rights and freedoms as American citizens were once threatened and tested. Today's government is comprised of African American legislators, city and county leaders, and heads of state agencies. And whereas looking to the past, a governor stood in the schoolhouse door where 9 brave young souls would not settle for a second-class education. Today, 61 years later, many are still fighting to find equality for every child in Arkansas. And whereas we have come so far, but we must never lose sight of how far we still have to go. All Arkansans deserve the right to the best that our state has to offer, and we must not forget the men and women who work tirelessly for freedom, civil rights, and equality for all people, and whose deeds help to broaden and enrich American culture. Therefore, I, Asa Hutchinson, Governor of the State of Arkansas, do proclaim February 2018 as Black History Month across the state of Arkansas, and I urge all citizens to neither forget the painful past nor lose sight of the promise of the future.
Good morning. For those of you who do not know me, my name is David Ware, and I have the honor to be the historian of this Capitol. I welcome you on behalf of the Secretary of State. You honored this house by your presence, and as far as the Philander Smith College Choir is concerned, you show us what rooms like this are made for. Thank you. And thanks also to Representative Flowers for having asked me to participate in this today. To date, nearly 150 African Americans have served in the chambers of the Arkansas Legislature. Over half of these held office before the turn of the 20th century. Initially elected as members of Reconstruction governments, Black legislators remained active and visible in both chambers through the 1870s and 1880s. Many came from counties dominated by agriculture, but others represented Arkansas cities such as Helena, Pine Bluff, and Little Rock, towns that were characterized by large and prosperous professional African-American populations. Almost all of them in the 19th century were Republicans, although a handful ran as Greenbackers and a couple even ran as Democrats. By the 1890s, however, African-Americans faced new obstacles to voting and were effectively abandoned by both political parties. 12 African Americans served in the 1891 Assembly. By 1895, there were none. And there would be no more for almost 8 decades. That changed in 1973 when 4 African Americans took their places in the Assembly. Richard Mays, Dr. William Townsend, Henry Wilkins III, and Dr. Jerry Jewell. They were few, but their numbers would increase. Today, African Americans make up about 11% of Arkansas's legislature, 3 state senators, 11 state representatives. Now, one obstacle to understanding the work of Arkansas's historic African American legislators has been the seemingly simple task of identifying them, finding out who they were. After their disappearance from the legislature, they were simply overlooked by many historians. In historic rosters, their names were either misspelled or were simply left off over time. Funny how that happens. Beginning in the 1960s, however, this tendency was reversed as historians sought to get a better understanding of Arkansas's legislative past. In 1979, Tom Dillard suggested that perhaps as many as 50 African Americans had served in the legislature in the 19th century. Since then, scholarship using census records, directories, and contemporary journalism has enlarged that figure a little bit. In 2006, Dr. Blake Wintery could identify some 84 African Americans who had served in the House and Senate. Subsequent research has found another couple. Now, who were these early African American lawmakers? The short answer is a pretty diverse bunch. About half of them farmed at some point in their careers, but their occupations also included the ministry, education, the law, medical, and mercantile pursuits. 28 of them had served as local or county officers or officials. An overwhelming majority were literate. Their average wealth was higher than that of most Black Arkansans. Most importantly, though, what distinguishes them, what unifies them, was their willingness to serve. They were leaders who understood that old-fashioned notion of civic duty. Now, there's a saying I heard a long time ago, "He is not dead whose name is yet spoken." He is not dead whose name is yet spoken. Our exhibit is one attempt to keep speaking the names of these Solons, these citizens, these leaders. It represents the work of many hands. Some 60 years ago, when I first came to the Capitol, as a relatively young man. Dr. Kerry Wynn Jr. of Pine Bluff encouraged me to find some way to keep the story of Arkansas's black legislators in public view. A few years later, my friend Blake Winter's research reclaimed the names and careers of many of the first generation of these public servants. In 2012, the Arkansas History Commission, today known as the Arkansas State Archives, what you might call the senior division of the Department of Arkansas Heritage, whose director is over there, by the way, Ms. Hurst, in collaboration with the Arkansas Black History Commission, created a traveling exhibit that collected for the first time all known images of Arkansas's 19th century African-American legislators. Two years later, we in the Secretary of State's office compiled a companion exhibit of those legislators from the 20th and 21st centuries. At the time, I discussed with the commission's curator, my friend Julianne Crawford, the possibility of creating a single unified exhibit. And this year, we've done so, working with my talented colleague, artist Jennifer Hughes, to create these panels, to keep these names in public view again. Now, these legislators' histories and accomplishments cannot be contained in a single exhibit, but we can at least speak their names and look in their eyes, both during Black History Month and throughout the rest of the year. The Solons of recent decades have followed in the steps of their 19th century predecessors. They've not been content to simply honor history, but through their public service, they, like the first generation of African American legislators, have made it. Thank you very much.
As we near the end of our program, I want to remind you that lunch will be provided over at the Capitol Hill apartment building just next door to the north of the Capitol and right next door to the AEA building. And now, Director Carlos Chapel will lead the awesome Philander Smith Choir and close our program with Lift Every Voice and Sing by James Weldon Johnson, which is printed on the back of your programs. Enjoy.